Hello students, I am Dr. Aruna Mohan discussing with you sexual reproduction. In the previous program, we have understood why reproduction is so important for the continuation of species. Also, we are aware of the fact that there are two major types of reproduction, asexual reproduction and sexual reproduction. Today, in this program, we will discuss in detail sexual reproduction. Before I go into the detail of sexual reproduction, I would like to tell you certain deviations in reproductive strategies. One deviation in reproductive strategy is hermaphroditism, in which both the sexes are present in the same body. For example, earthworm, tapeworm. Earthworm has testis as well as ovary in the body, hence producing sperms as well as ova in the same body. The only thing which is slightly different from the normal is that in spite of the fact that both the gametes, sperm and ova, are present inside the same body, fertilization will not take place within the same body. Earthworm will go for cross fertilization. Sperm from one earthworm will enter the other earthworm and from other to the first earthworm. It is called cross fertilization. So, in spite of the fact that earthworm is hermaphrodite, goes for cross fertilization. Children, here I would like to remind you that sexual reproduction is a reproduction which is really required for evolution, for further special features in the organism. So, every organism tried its best to go towards sexual reproduction. You have heard about paramecium in asexual reproduction, but even paramecium, which is single celled, which goes binary fission reproduction, has tried for sexual reproduction by means of conjugation. You must have studied in your class or in lower classes also that two paramecia come close to each other. A continuation, a duct is made between the two paramecium, that is cytoplasmic connection, and nuclear material in the form of gamete is exchanged. You very well can imagine when paramecium is dividing by binary fission, it will have the same genetic material generation after generation. Even if they are exchanging, the exchange results into nothing. It remains the same genetic material, but it only shows that even paramecium tried to exhibit sexual reproduction, though it did not result into anything. They remained two, they exchanged the material, they remained two, finally divided by binary fission. But when we talk of sexuality, it started as early as paramecium, that is single cell organism. So, you can understand the beginning of sexuality is even in the unicellular organism, though it became functional only in higher, bigger individuals. Coming back to earthworm, it is an example of hermaphrodite, and tapeworm, which we sometimes have in our alimentary canal, is another example of hermaphroditism. In case of tapeworm, it is made up of many segments and each segment is full individual having testis and ovary. There is another deviation in reproductive strategy, and that is parthenogenesis. That the egg, without undergoing fertilization, develops into an adult. Good examples are aphids and rotifers. Later on, our scientist made use of this technique. Take one egg, just prick it, initiate the process of development, and it develops into full individual. Or take any cell of the body and initiate developmental process by different means, and it develops into full individual. Our famous Dolly is example of that. Now, I come to male reproductive system, and first I will explain different parts in reproductive system. When we come to sexual reproduction, sex gland has to be there. In case of man, it is testis. So man has a pair of testis, that means two testis, and they are placed outside the abdomen or in the extra abdominal position. I don't mean to say that they are outside the body. They are outside the abdomen in a bag-like structure called scrotum, which is attached to the body near groin area and connected to abdomen by inguinal canal. So it is indirectly connected to the body, otherwise it is outside the body. Why it is so? The reason is, in the testis, spermatogenesis will take place, and that needs the temperature slightly lower than the body temperature, and that is provided only outside the body. Spermatogenesis will finally result into sperm formation. So testis is in the scrotum, and from testis come out small channels called vasa efferentia or vas efferens, which will enter into another structure called epididymis, that is also in the scrotum outside the abdominal cavity. Sperms are produced in the testis and they are stored in the epididymis. Why they are stored in the epididymis? For maturation, for aging. Now from this epididymis, the epididymis has three parts: caput epididymis, cauda epididymis, corpus epididymis. They store sperms. From cauda epididymis come out few channels again, and together they make one channel, and that is called vas deferens. Now this vas deferens originates in the scrotum. This is extension of epididymis, and then it enters inguinal canal and enters the abdominal cavity. So inguinal canal is a small channel which allows this vas deferens to pass through, but will not allow testis to pass through it and go to abdomen. Once testis remains in abdomen by any chance, then it is not functional. It cannot produce sperms. So testis should be scrotal, not abdominal. By any chance, if this inguinal canal is damaged or disturbed or stretched, then part of alimentary canal may slip into the scrotum, which will be now called inguinal hernia. Coming back to vas deferens. Vas deferens from both the sides. There are two testes, so there will be two vas deferens. So these two vas deferens from both the sides moving in the abdominal cavity, and they will meet each other behind urinary bladder, and then they pass through prostatic duct. They lose their independent identity the moment they meet each other, and after that they make a common passage called urethra. You can see in this diagram, urethra is passing through prostate, and near that only you can see seminal vesicles. Seminal vesicles will release watery fluid, which is rich in nutrition. It will provide nutrition to the semen or to the sperms. At this point, I should tell you the difference between sperm and semen. Sperm is produced by testis stored in epididymis, transported by vas deferens. Once it reaches in urethra, for further survival, it needs nutrition and it needs to move. Nutrition is coming from seminal vesicle and prostatic glands, and fluid medium is already there in which it can easily swim. Now it is in urethra, and urethra continues as penis, and penis again comes outside the abdominal cavity, and we can see penis from outside. At this point, I should also remind you that human is the example of sexual dimorphism. That means by looking at the body of the individual, you can say whether it is a male or a female. So, penis is part of male external genitalia. Urethra continues into penis. At the base of penis, there is one more gland called Cowper's gland or bulbourethral gland. It secretes a secretion which gives lubrication. Now, through urethra, the fluid with sperms is passing, and this is semen, and this will be ejaculated out into the vagina of the female. Please appreciate what a long distance the sperm travels, starting with testes to epididymis to vas deferens to urethra to penis, then deposited in the vagina of the female, then uterus of the female, and then it will go up to the fallopian tube near ovary, almost near ovary of the female, to fertilize the ovum. Since sperm has to travel such a long distance, and that is why sperm has a tail. In this diagram, I am showing you transverse section of testes, where you can see seminiferous tubules on the left side and also epididymis cut section. On the right side, you can see enlarged portion of seminiferous tubule showing developing germ cells and Sertoli cells, and in the interstitial spaces you can see interstitial cells or Leydig cells, which are source of male hormone called testosterone. The germ cells will develop into sperm, the Sertoli cells will provide nutrition and protection, and Leydig cells will provide male hormone. Here you can see spermatogenesis going on the upper side you see spermatogonia, spermatid or primary spermatocyte, secondary spermatocyte, spermatid, and then the sperm. On the right side you see sperm, head, middle piece and tail. Head is conical, the acrosome, which helps in penetration. And this shows the penis transverse section. It has three muscle bands, two called corpus cavernosa and one is corpus spongiosum. These muscles help penis to become tough, elongated, and is called erectile penis and is able to deposit sperms in the vagina. So, male reproductive system is developed so that needful can be done in transferring sperm from male's body to the female's body. With this, we have come to the end of male reproductive system, which includes testes, epididymis, vas deferens, seminal vesicles, prostate, Cowper's gland and penis. Testes is the primary sex organ and all other organs are secondary sex organs or accessory sex organs. Thank you.